Father, we are so grateful to be together like this, and Lord, to have been able to come around your table and go through those emotions, Lord, of being sorrowful and then thankful and then joyful and hopeful. And you do that for us whenever we come into your presence, Lord. You lift us out of our current situations and you remind us why we do what we do. You remind us that we're heaven bound. Lord, you remind us of the eternity that awaits us, Lord. And also you remind us of the work that needs to be done between now and then, God. So thank you. Thank you for your presence speaking to our hearts, Lord. Thank you for the beautiful music. We're excited, Lord, for the coming weeks to have some of these different languages incorporated in our worship, Lord. That's going to be a little bit like heaven. And Father, we thank you for the beautiful diversity of your church as well, God. Won't you bless your word to our hearts, Lord, and let it bring incredible life and growth to us, I pray, in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Wow, guys, thank you. Just loving church, loving God. Don't know about you. He's so awesome, and it's so awesome to serve him. Guys, last week we had Bruce Benge here. If you were away, I'd really encourage you to get that message online. So many people, we just had so much positive feedback about that message, and just sensing that it was such a timely word for the Lighthouse. So you can get that on our website if you are really, it's really worth a watch. And if you want to tell your friends, we're still broadcasting our videos live on YTV and Arrow FM. Those go out at 7 p.m. on a Thursday night, and also Sunday morning at 9 a.m. and 7 p.m. So if you want to encourage friends to watch that or get what's going on online, that's a really great way to reach other people with the gospel. Other good news is that the Point Youth Group is away with the young adult leaders. They're having a wonderful time down at Riversdale. So just carry them in your hearts as they have their last morning together, and trust that God does wonderful things amongst our young people. I'm going to read from Romans 16, verse 3 to 5. And it says, "Greet Priscilla and Aquila, my fellow workers in Christ Jesus, who risked their necks for my life, to whom not only I give thanks, but all the churches of the Gentiles give thanks as well. Greet also the church that meets in their house." We're doing a short series called The Commendable Church from Romans 16, and it's the end of Paul's great theological treatise to the church in Rome. But it's so beautiful because it's so personal, and in it he commends his beloved friends, and he greets them with warm, deep relationship. And what's beautiful about this is that we see at the end of this great theology document, that theology being lived out in the lives and the relationships of God's people. And good theology always leads to good behavior. Good theology always leads to good life amongst God's people. And we're going to look again. We started looking at this one couple that Paul commends, Priscilla and Aquila. They were great champions of the gospel. And they mentioned seven times in Scripture. And last week we started looking at them, but there's another really important aspect of their lives that we want to learn from today. So we're going to look at one or two of those mentions again, just to put the thing in context, especially for those who weren't here 2 weeks ago. I'm going to read from Acts 18, verse 18 to 21. And it says, "Paul stayed on in Corinth for some time. Then he left the brothers and sisters and sailed for Syria, accompanied by Priscilla and Aquila. Before he sailed, he had his hair cut off at Cenchreae because of a vow he had taken. They arrived at Ephesus, where Paul left Priscilla and Aquila. He himself went into the synagogue and reasoned with the Jews. When they asked him to spend more time with them, he declined. But as he left, he promised, 'I will come back if it is God's will.' And then he set sail for Ephesus." Then I'm reading Acts 18, verse 24 to 28. And it says, "Meanwhile, a Jew named Apollo, a native of Alexandria, came to Ephesus. He was a learned man and with thorough knowledge of the Scripture. And he had been instructed in the way of the Lord, and he spoke with great fervor and taught about Jesus accurately, though he knew only the baptism of John. he began to speak boldly in the synagogue. When Priscilla and Aquila heard him, they invited him to their home and explained to them the way of God more accurately. When Apollo wanted to go to Achaia, the brothers and the sisters encouraged him and wrote to the disciples there to welcome him. And when he arrived, he was a great help to those who by the grace of God believed. And he vigorously refuted the Jewish opponents in public debate, proving that from the scriptures that Jesus was the Messiah. We saw last week this couple, they're an amazing couple, they're always mentioned together. And we saw last week they had just been exiled from Rome and they were setting up their tent-making business in Greece and they met the Apostle Paul. They immediately welcomed him into their home and they began working together with him in their tent-making business. But while they were together, they started to catch the heart that was burning in that apostle, that heart to reach the nations. And even though they were refugees, they immediately started aligning their lives with the great call of God to reach the lost. And we see that very shortly after this, they begin to go with Paul on apostolic missions. They go across into Turkey to plant a church in Ephesus, and they assist the apostle in his great church planting endeavor. They also we see while they're in Ephesus, Paul leaves them there getting on with the work, and they meet this guy Apollo, who is a man with an apostolic anointing on his life. And the Bible says that the two of them instructed him further in the ways of the Lord, and they launched him out into a new level of anointing in his apostolic mandate. Last week we saw that one of the main things that Paul compliments them for, he says, "These are my beloved co-workers. These are my beloved," and that word co-worker in the Greek means a fellow laborer or a fellow helper or a companion in labor. And we saw last week that it comes from the Greek sun, which means close together, and ergos, which means to toil or labor. But you put them together, you get the words sun ergos. And we recognize that in English as synergy. We get that word, the English word synergy, from that. And just the one definition this week, the Oxford Dictionary says, synergy is the extra energy, power, success that is achieved by two or more people, companies, or elements working together instead of on their own. And this working together of people with complementary but different gifts is the key to the power of this couple's life. They were always working together. They worked together with Paul. They worked together with other cultures as they went from nation to nation. And their secret was their synergy. But what I want to look at today is just the power of that synergy within their marriage. And we see that, as I mentioned, all through the scriptures, whenever they are mentioned as a marriage team. Sometimes Aquila is mentioned first, sometimes Priscilla is mentioned first. Some scholars say that's significant, some say it's not. We can draw our own conclusions, but it is fascinating that in a world where men dominated, that sometimes the Apostle Paul did, when he talked of that couple, he did mention Priscilla first. And so there's some conclusions we may draw from that, but I'm going to leave that up to you and the Holy Spirit to make your own conclusions. What is so clear, though, is that this is an inseparable marriage team, and we can learn a lot from their exemplary life and the synergos, the synergy that took place within their marriage. They're either working together in the family business, or they're working together as they host people, or they're working together as they're going to help plant a church, or they're working together even when they ministered to that apostolic gift of Apollo. And what I love about it is she wasn't making the tea. The Bible says that together they strengthen that man in his knowledge of the way. They both added to his life. And we're looking at this beautiful, what it's like to be part of a Christ-centered marriage today. This is what Charles Spurgeon said about this couple. He says, "When two loving hearts pull together, they accomplish wonders. What different associations cluster around the names Priscilla and Aquila from those which are awakened by the words Ananias and Sapphira? There we have a husband and a wife conspiring in hypocrisy, And here we have a husband and a wife united in sincere devotion. And isn't that beautiful that we're looking at a couple that in their unity there was an incredible power released way beyond what they could have achieved as individuals. Now I want to say to the singles today, I don't want you to feel left out. Okay, because you're not in any way in that phase of life or in that calling, you are no way inferior. Just because we're talking about the power of marriage today. 1 Corinthians 7 verse 32 to 34 says this, talks about the honorable position of being single. And it says, but I want you to be free from concern. One who is unmarried is concerned about the things of the Lord and how he may please the Lord. But one who is married is concerned about the things of the world and how he may please his wife. His interests are divided. The woman who is unmarried and the virgin is concerned about the things of the Lord, that she may be holy both in body and in spirit. But the one who is married is concerned about the things of the world, how she may please her husband. Paul celebrates the single status, and because there's an incredible capacity to serve God when you like that. Now, I only got married when I was 43, okay? It took so long for me to get ready to marry such a beautiful wife, and it took so long for me to find such an amazing woman. But in those 43 years, I wasn't idle. There were a great period for serving God. I was able to go on missions, go away for as long as I liked, be busy every night of the week in ministry without neglecting a family. It's a wonderful time. And guys, if you're in that phase or you're called to that, don't waste that. It's an honorable calling. And it's a powerful thing to be living in that kind of phase. What is interesting, this passage also speaks to us as married couples. Because it says here that we do have an obligation to consider the desires of our spouse. We do have an obligation to take into account their will. We are not a separate entity. And quite often that if our spouse doesn't have the same passion for the kingdom, we need to take that into account. And we can become distracted and divided. And it's interesting, with God's high view of marriage, He doesn't say, well, if you like that, just leave your partner and carry on with what you believe God's call is for your life. He says, no, there's a way that you have to work that out, and the way that you have to bring God's will into both of your lives. God has a very high regard. But if we look at Priscilla and Aquila, we can see they didn't have this problem. They didn't have divided distraction because they both had the same passion. They both carried the same heart, and there was a beautiful synergy between them. Amos 3 verse 3 says this, do two walk together unless they agree to do so? And when you are in marriage, whether you come into an agreement about the call of God upon your lives, there's an incredible synergy that takes place. And spouses have an incredible capacity in our lives to either spur us on or pull us back. And that's the way God has designed it. It's very fascinating. I was looking in 1 Kings 11 verse 1 to 4, and it talks about King Solomon, who was the wisest and possibly one of the most powerful kings of his time. And King Solomon, it says, King Solomon, however, loved many foreign women besides Pharaoh's daughter, Moabites and Amorites and Edomites and Sidonians and Hittites. They were from the nations about which the Lord told the Israelites, you must not intermarry with them, because they will surely turn your hearts after their gods. Nevertheless, Solomon held fast to them in love, and he had 700 wives of royal birth and 300 concubines, and his wives led him astray. As Solomon grew old, his wives turned his heart to other gods, and his heart was not fully devoted to the Lord his God, as the heart of his father David had been. I don't know why the Holy Spirit's striking my heart. What a tragedy. He was a king that God had given supernatural wisdom. And if you'll forgive the stereotypical joke, if he was so wise, how did he end up with 700 mother-in-laws? Okay? My mother-in-law has always been a total honey to me, so that is really a stereotype. But if you think about this situation, 1,000 women, okay, that were at his command. If one of them had a headache, he could move on. If one of them wasn't in the mood or was feeling tired, he had 997 other women to pick from his harem. You'd think he had all the power. You'd think he'd have all the control, but not at all. Those women led his heart astray. His father had had despite his rocky career, his passion for God was never diminished. But this man was led after false idols. Friends, the person we have physical intimacy with, we are bound together emotionally and spiritually, and they have an incredible influence over our final destiny. And what a tragedy that Solomon, despite all his wisdom, and despite having all the power and all the women in the world he could possibly want, they led him astray because of that bond that exists. 2 Corinthians 16 verse 14 says this: "Do not be unequally yoked with unbelievers, for what partnership has righteousness with lawlessness, and what fellowship has light with darkness?" This is a beautiful picture, and it extends beyond marriage, but it talks about the power of the yoke. And I think we've got an image there. When two oxen are pulling together in that yoke, their power is more than doubled. Now, I found a little music stand thing that I thought would I wanted to make a wooden yoke, but I found this thing, so this is going to suffice. So I want to ask my beautiful, lovely bride to come up and be yoked together with me in the synergy of marriage. It's very close together, so we're going to be very, very cozy here in the yoke. Okay. Now, the beautiful thing. She asked me, why are we going that way? I think it's exactly illustrative of what this is. My love, when you're preaching, you always go from left to right if you're going into the future.
Okay.
So that's why the cross is over there. It's the way we read.
Okay. I understand it.
Okay, so now the beautiful thing is if we're together like this and we pull together, it more than doubles our energy. But if one of us pulls back, if it's going to be a situation like this, it's going to be less than halved. But God has designed for this beautiful synergy. Sean, I wonder if you could come and help us. The other thing is, if we're going that way, we're going that way. Won't you come and help us, Sean? Sean's going to be the Lord in this scenario, and so he's got the beard for it. He's going to lead us, and if we both follow the Lord and we're going to pull together, there's going to be an incredible synergy. There's going to be an incredible power. Thank you very much.
He missed his opportunity to spur me on with love.
That synergy of pulling together. And the beautiful thing is that when we come together like that, you saw immediately, it was interesting, Sandy says, why are we going that way? When you put two people in a yoke, there are two wills involved. And you're going to have that. You're going to have this difference, and God means it that way. But when those two wills start to submit to the will of Jesus, there's an incredible power and energy released, and amazing stuff happens. God intended this from the very first. Genesis 2:18 says this: "Then the Lord said, 'It is not good for a man that a man should be alone. I will make a helper fit for him.'" This passage reveals a lot about the plan of God. And guys, what it reveals is we are not adequate in ourselves as a species. Okay? Sorry, spoiler alert. We like to think so sometimes, but God says, actually, I've made it such that you are not complete without woman folk, the other half of the species. And I've had to make you a helper to help you. And I've made you a helper that is fit for you. And this is an amazing thing that happens. When God spoke of a helper, We've looked at this before. The Greek word is that an ezer, and it doesn't mean a subordinate. It doesn't mean a 2IC or a PA, my beautiful assistant. It's actually a very, very powerful term, and most times in the Old Testament that word ezer is used, it's used of God. Okay, so it's a highly respected term. It's not just an assistant. And then that word fit for talks about perfectly complementary, complementing you as a counterpart that will fulfill you. Listen to what the Munz Dictionary of Biblical Words says. With so many references to God as our helper, it is obvious that an ezer is in no ways inferior to the one who receives the help. This is important because this is the word God uses in Genesis 2:18 when he says about Adam, "It is not good for the man to be alone. I will make a helper suitable for him." God then forms Eve as his ezer. According to God's design, therefore, the man and the woman, the husband and the wife, are designed by God to stand together and help each other fight the battles of life. And there is a divine ezer, and God is there as the divine ezer to help them. Isn't that beautiful, that we must be so careful to give each other, across the gender difference, the honor and respect that God has intended. When we look at that, our helper is not someone who's subservient to us, but who's actually a co-worker, a beautiful sun ergos in the purpose of life. We can't not do this beautiful scripture in Ecclesiastes. I don't know, it gets used in so many weddings. Ecclesiastes 4 verse 9 to 12 says this, "Two are better than one because they have good reward for their toil. If they fall, one will lift up his fellow. But woe to him who is alone when he falls and has not another to lift him up. Again, if two lie down together, they keep warm. But how can one keep warm alone? And though a man might prevail against one who is alone, two will withstand him. A threefold cord is not quickly broken." And I love this. I've got a little image there of a threefold cord. And obviously, we can understand very clearly the strength of those different cords wound together and weaved together, combining the strength of all of them. But I love what it talks about, how he suddenly starts talking about a threefold cord. And here, the writer of Ecclesiastes is bringing Jesus, bringing God into it. And in any marriage, if Jesus is the center cord, and we wind ourselves around him, as we wind ourselves around each other as couples, we're gonna be not only strengthened, but we're going to be on the right course, just as we had with that yoke illustration. And the beautiful thing about this is it says when two are close together, you keep warm. There's an increase of temperature with proximity. And the closer we are together as husband and wife, the closer we are together as members of the body of Christ, the greater the temperature is going to be. And the other beautiful thing is, the hotter the body that's against you, the warmer you're going to become. In these cold Kiwi days, I like to take a hot water bottle. Nobody knows I'm sitting at my desk. I don't like to burn the heater. I take a hot water bottle, and I just have it against me. And it's amazing how your body heats up from that little hot water bottle, because it's so hot. And if we've got, one of us is burning brightly, burning hotly, and we don't, contact, we're in proximity with others, that temperature is going to spread, and it's going to cause others to be set on fire for Jesus. I learned an interesting thing the other day from Greg. We were trying to light the fire, but there was cold air in the chimney, and we couldn't get the fire going at the base because of the cold air in the chimney. And how important, what a beautiful picture that is, as a husband and wife, as a father and a mother, we want to make sure that there's the top, we're not cold at the top. Well, how will we get the fire of Jesus to burn in the lives of our children if we're cold? It's a challenge to leadership as well, that we burn brightly so that those, our offspring, can catch that fire. They can catch fire and they can burn brightly. I also want to point out, I know some people are married to unsaved spouses, and at this point, be encouraged, because there's an incredible power in there being just a believer in the mix. Okay, and there's a scripture in Corinthians that your spouse might seem totally cold, but God can use you in your marriage to light that fire. And I haven't included the whole scripture, but the scripture in 1 Corinthians 7 verse 16, it says, "And how do you know, wife, whether you will bring your husband to salvation? Or how do you know, husband, whether you will bring your wife to salvation?" And it actually talks about how an unsaved spouse brings a sanctification upon a marriage, even if there's an unsaved spouse in that situation. So there's an incredible calling, there's an incredible perseverance, and there's an incredible power even in one brightly burning brand within the marriage situation. So do not lose hope. I'm going to look at a passage at 1 Peter 3 verse 5 to 7. It says, "For this is how the holy woman who hoped in God used to adorn themselves by submitting to their own husbands, as Sarah obeyed Abraham, calling him Lord, and you are his children if you do good and do not fear anything that is frightening. Likewise, husbands, live with your wives in an understanding way, showing honor to the woman as the weaker vessel, since they are heirs with you of the grace of life, so that your prayers may not be hindered." This is a great passage, and it highlights in many ways the great equality, the great just commonality between man and woman, and at the same time it highlights the differences that create the beautiful synergy. And it says here that we are both heirs of the grace of life. Now, most commentators see that as we are both saved in the same way by Jesus. We both come into that incredible situation of sonship before God, regardless of our gender. And it's a beautiful picture of the equality that exists between man and woman. I think it also, some commentators believe it's also how we come together as man and woman to produce another generation, to produce offspring. And how incredible is it that people with unique genes come together and mix those genes, mix that DNA to produce other beautiful, completely unique individuals. And that's a beautiful picture about how when a man and woman come together and they combine their gifts, they synergize their differences in a mature way, that it produces life in other people. It produces life within the body of Christ. And there's an incredible power. But what I love about this passage is it talks about the honor for the wife. The Bible says to men, we must honor woman. That word time is it's to treat as a precious treasure, to highly regard. And there's no place for misogyny in our theology. There's no place for even subtle misogyny within our church community. Misogyny is when a man believes that men are better than women. And I don't know if somehow I think all men at some point we're guilty of that. It's part of our testosterone arrogance, I think. Don't shoot me if that's never been the case with you. But here the Bible says we must honor the woman around us, because they make up 50% of God's plan for the earth. They make up 50% of the body of Christ. And then the Bible also says that wives are to honor their husbands as they submit to their servant-hearted leadership. This is like a fest of a culture of honor, of honoring each other. And that's what God intends for the body of Christ and for marriage. There's also differences in this passage. It's interesting that it talks about woman as the weaker vessel. Now, it's pretty clear that if you look at biology, if you look at physiology generally, I'm just talking about generally, men have the biomechanical advantage over women. The testosterone causes them, I better be careful with all the doctors in the house, but their bodies develop generally more harder and hairier, more robust and strong. And God plans that for purpose. He also, women are motivated by different hormones that make them far more tender and far more able to bond, because they've got to bring children into the world. They can't do it alone, but they bring children into the world. And they're wired differently. They're more intuitive, more emotionally sensitive. I'm told that there's even a difference Well, apart from the glorious complementary difference of reproductive organs, which make marriage a lot of fun and a very fruitful thing, thank God for those differences. There's also a difference in the way our brains are. Apparently, men's brains are generally larger than ladies' brains. But guys, don't think that means you're more intelligent, because with that argument, elephants and sperm whales are more intelligent than you. But there is a difference. Women's brains have more white matter, and white matter is the material that connects the areas of the brain, the hemispheres of the brain. Women are far more able to multitask. They're far more connected. When you go into a shop, the women are like, there's a sale there, I've got to look at that. Guys are like, guys, we're far more tunnel vision. We've got more our gray matter. We have less connectivity. So we go shopping. We're like the hunter. We go and we get that thing. Women are like the browsers, and they're able to connect sensory information in a way that we cannot. And we're different. We think differently. The old thing: men are from Mars, women are from Venus. You know, and we're aliens. But God says, I made you different so that you could synergos, so that you could work together, that you could complement each other. Not only that, not only are there those differences, but there's also, don't let me get ahead of myself, there's also personality differences when two people come together. And God brings those together. And you know what the interesting thing is? So often, the thing that attracts you to someone while you're courting is the differences, is the strengths you see in them that you don't find in yourself. But they are differences. Then when you get married, after a while, those things start to become the things that irritate you. Those differences are the things that irritate you because you're different. And why does my wife want to be going that way when I want to be going that way? And the whole direction thing, I'm sure you've walked down that road as a marriage couple. Go that way, no, go, no. Those differences start to become a point of contention. But if we mature and we work past how we are different so that those differences start to complement each other, we get into a beautiful phase of cooperation. Sandy talks about it as the grape juice phase. Those are the early days of our marriage. And then there's the vinegar phase, where those differences start to create the tensions. And then it becomes the wine. The beautiful, mature wine, where we're working together, and that's what we want to work together. We also see that, those differences in personality. Sandy, in Romans 12, there's nine gifts that are really like the way we're wired, and one of them is teacher, which is what I am, and teachers think they know everything, and they've got a way of looking at things. Sandy, her strongest gift is like the prophecy, like a perceiver. Perceivers also think they see everything in black and white, but they also think they know exactly how things should be, but they see things slightly different to teachers. So very often when you get someone who's strong in that gifting and strong in my gifting, you knock heads because you both believe you see the thing exactly as it should be, and you knock heads. But as we've knocked heads a lot, but we've learned that I've learned now her perceiving is giving a different perspective on the matter that my teacher orientation is giving. And I see things just in terms of theory. And so often she'll say to me, Bruce, you've taught me this theory, but the decision you're going to make, you're actually contradicting your belief, your teaching. Because can you see what's actually going on? And I'm like, oh, it's like I wasn't looking at the radar. I wasn't looking at the scanners. But when God brings you together, your gifts complement each other. And there's a whole variety of beautiful gifts, and no marriage is the same. Some couples say, we never fight. It could be because they're both carers, and they're wired to just care for each other. When you've got a teacher gifting and a prophet gifting, it's a whole lot more difficult. And you'll find that, but the beautiful thing is when you realize you've been put together, it's God who's put you together. And those differences that might cause the head knocking are actually beautiful strengths that God wants to bring together into a beautiful synergy beneath His yoke. We also see in Scripture that men and women have different roles, and I haven't got time to go into this in detail. It's not always the most PC subject, but the Bible does encourage women to submit to the leadership of their husbands. Why God chose men to be leaders I don't know. Sometimes I think women are better leaders, okay? But God chose, He chose men to be made first, and He chose men to lead in the family. And I can't argue with Him, okay? He does it because it doesn't in any way diminish our worth before Him. And we see it, we see God chose for the for marriage and the family to represent who He is. And we see exactly the same thing in the Trinity. Jesus and the Father and the Holy Spirit are equal. Jesus is equal to the Father, yet God leads the Trinity, and Jesus chose to submit to the Father. And we see this in Philippians 2, verse 5 to 7. And it says, "Have this mind amongst yourselves, which is yours in Christ Jesus, who though He was in the form of God, did not count equality with God a thing to be grasped, but emptied Himself, taking on the form of a servant, being born in the likeness of men, and becoming found in human form, He humbled Himself and became obedient to the point of death, even death on the cross." And we see in the Trinity this beautiful picture of loving, servant-hearted leadership, and loving, cheerful submission. And it's so important because as rebellious sons of Adam and Eve, God needs to bring us under His authority. And the devil has tried to mess up the picture of authority, but in the Trinity and in Jesus we see it. We see as He leads the church, He doesn't lead with this is my way or the highway. He leads with a way that serves us and blesses us and brings out the best in us. And that's what a husband should do as he leads. And a wife honors her husband, and the husband honors the wife. It's not this one above the other, but it's two together in the yoke, listening to Jesus together, getting the combined picture. If I can use a very guy picture, when you're on the bridge of a ship, you have a navigating officer and you have a radar operator. And if the navigating officer doesn't listen to the radar operator, you're going to be in trouble. If the radar operator doesn't listen to the navigating officer, you're going to be in trouble. The navigating officer says, "This is the plan." The radar operator says, "No, wait a minute. There's something in the way you didn't see. You've got to make a course alter. Together, you find the safest course." Guys, God has put into our lives much better radar operators. They're more perceptive. They see stuff we don't see. They see stuff differently to what we see. We see, ladies, the navigating officer sees stuff different to you. When you're brought together, there's this beautiful synergy that works out to the glory of God, and it becomes a model to your children of what loving authority is, and servant-hearted leadership, and loving, cheerful submission is, and they can follow that picture as they follow God. They're able to submit to Him. And just in closing, there's something so beautiful here. It says here in this passage in 1 Peter, it says, "Dwelling together." And I asked my friend who's a boffin in Greek, he translates the Greek Bible for himself when he's doing sermons, and he says, that's a beautiful, that dwelling together talks about the just living together beautifully. Living together harmoniously, living together well. And when we live together well, we become an example to the whole church. We become an example to our family. We become an example to the whole church. And this was Aquila and Priscilla. They had the church in their house. The church invaded their home. They had a home that could be an example to the church, that they could incorporate the church into their home. It was not just hospitality, but it was example. Because of they dwelled together well. They dwelled together in harmony and synergy. And there was an incredible power in that. And then this passage goes on to say, it says, when you are both doing this, your prayers will not be hindered. And that's not a singular there. That's the plural. That's your prayers together. And there's nothing more powerful than a husband and wife praying. Actually, no, I don't know if that's true. There is something incredibly powerful about a husband and wife praying together. And the thing is, your prayers will not be hindered when you're honoring each other as equal co-heirs, when you're recognizing the differences and you're not letting those cause division and strife and head knocking, and you start to work together as a team to bring life and blessing to other people, as you work together to advance the gospel. Incredible power is released. Your prayers take on a new level of authority. and power. Isn't God amazing? He's mysterious. I don't know why He makes the choices that He makes. I don't know why He makes us different. But He makes us different so that when we combine together, we have double the strength, more than double the strength in our synergy. I trust that however God wants to minister this to you, please in no way be discouraged. Trust God because He has a beautiful plan. But as married couples, the message is especially for married couples. Let's trust God for that synergy. Let's consider how we may spur one another on to love and good deeds. Let's be good yoke fellows, good synergos, to see how God wants to use our marriage to be a beautiful blessing and example to our children, and to be a beautiful blessing and an example as we minister to the church and as we minister to the world. Let's bow our heads. Father, we thank You for Your Word. We've covered a lot. We've looked into a lot. There's probably been quite a few loose ends left untied, and I pray no one will get the wrong picture, but maybe we'll be stirred to even dig deeper into the Scripture. But I thank You for this beautiful passage that we've looked at that so highlights our differences and so highlights our similarities and our equality in You. And I pray that You would help us. Help the Lighthouse Church, Lord. Help the marriages of the Lighthouse Church. Empower us by Your Spirit in this synergy, God, as co-workers, cooperating together, God. And let our marriages become powerful instruments in Your hand, instruments of ministry where we instruct, we're able to instruct others, bless others, host others, encourage others, and minister to others as we advance the gospel. God, I pray, touch our lives and let this place, I pray for the marriages, Lord God, as Christian marriages are under attack, I pray, keep us strong, Father, and let us grow in authority that our prayers will not be hindered. But Lord God, we'll see prayers answered. We'll see the kingdom come through our marriages and through our lives. In Jesus' mighty name I pray. Amen. Thank you for joining the Lighthouse online service. We trust that you were blessed by the message this morning. If you would like to get in touch with us for any reason, please call us on 06-377-0333 or email us at office@lighthouse.org.nz. We would also love to meet you, and we would love it if you came to join us for one of our Sunday services at the Lighthouse. These take place at 10 a.m. at 23 Intermediate Street, Solway, Masterton. We'd love to meet you.
Till from heaven you came running, there was a word.